1947, first quarter. In the factories of Europe, a battle for production. Shortages of material, shortages of manpower. It was a battle for survival, fought in the worst winter in living memory. Transport was paralyzed by ice and snow. With every means in their power, men struggled to free the lifelines of a continent. Because the trains had to wait, the people had to wait. For food, for fuel, for many of the necessities of life. The long-suffering suffered yet again. But despite the difficulties of travel, there was much diplomatic activity. In Paris, 5 peace treaties were signed by representatives of the Allies and by representatives of Germany's ex-allies, by the victors and by the vanquished. With these signatures, the Second World War was brought to its official end. In London, new threads were taken up. The French Prime Minister, Léon Blum, came to discuss trade relations between France and Britain. The British Foreign Secretary, Ernest Bevin, left for Dunkirk to sign an Anglo-French treaty of friendship. At Dover, 20 deputies of the Supreme Soviet arrived to study British life at first hand. Off the coast of Britain, the battleship Vanguard, carrying the King and Queen, sailed towards South Africa. For 175 years, Britain has ruled India. Today, a country of nearly 400 million people. Amongst them, many of the world's richest, millions of the world's poorest. A people clamoring for independence, but a people divided amongst themselves. Divided by creeds and politics, poles apart. On the one side, the Muslims, with their demands for Pakistan as a separate Muslim state. On the other, the Hindus, all for independence but strongly opposed to any kind of partition. Many times, the British government, in the person of Viceroy Lord Wavell, called meetings of the party leaders. Hindu, Pandit Nehru, Muslim, Ali Jinnah, and the mystic, saintly Mahatma Gandhi. And each time the meetings brought deadlock. Each time Indian unity seemed further away than ever. Now, the government at Westminster had taken a decisive step. Viscount Mountbatten was sent to replace Lord Wavell, to make a last attempt to achieve Indian unity before final British withdrawal in 1948. For India, the ceremonial departure of Lord Wavell signified the end of one era, the beginning of another. In 1948, the brightest jewel in the British crown was to be India for the Indians. But if in India there was withdrawal, in South Africa there was consolidation. The Vanguard arrived at Cape Town, and the British royal family started out on a tour of the Union. And the Union's people gave an all-out demonstration of loyalty. belt and kraal, the tribesmen came in their thousands to pay homage to their king. In South Africa, the ties of Commonwealth were strengthened. In Greece, Britain's problems were great. After years of war and occupation, the Greeks were torn by political unrest, and pressure from outside had further confused the issue. In the mountains, extremists waged guerrilla warfare against the forces of the government. But now another power was entering Greek affairs. In Washington, United States congressmen gathered for a significant speech from President Truman.
Great Britain finds itself under the necessity of reducing or liquidating its commitments in several parts of the world, including Greece. As in the case of Greece, if Turkey is to have the assistance it needs, the United States must supply it. We are the only country able to provide that help. The free peoples of the world look to us for support in maintaining their freedoms. If we falter in our leadership, we may endanger the peace of the world, and we shall surely endanger the welfare of this nation. Great responsibilities have been placed upon us by the swift movement of events. I am confident that the Congress will face these responsibilities squarely.
The President's speech marked a turning point in American history. Isolationism was dead. Henceforth, America was to be a power in the affairs of Europe. To the frozen capital of Soviet Russia came the foreign ministers. Monsieur Vyshinsky welcomed Mr. Ernest Bevin from Great Britain, Monsieur Bideau from France, Mr. Marshall from the United States of America. The principal items for discussion were the difficult and all-important problems of Germany. The problem of the future of 80 million defeated people, of those who cooperated and those who didn't. The problem of the shattered industries of the Ruhr, vital powerhouse for Western Europe. All the complex problems of restoring a nation, but not its power of making war. But the future of Germany, and in fact of every nation, depended upon the unity of the great powers. The peoples of the world waited and wondered. Was this unity just a hope? Or could it be a reality?